Well, good evening, everybody. My name is Ted Huntington, and I am a coordinator for the Chandler Coalition on Youth Substance Abuse. I do have a cheering section in the front row helping me along here, which is nice to have. On behalf of the Chandler Coalition on Youth Substance Abuse and ICANN, it is our pleasure to welcome you to the City of Chandler's Call to Action for Prescription Medication Misuse and Abuse Initiative. We would like to acknowledge the presence of some of the following dignitaries that are here with us tonight. We have Chandler Vice Mayor Kevin Hartke. We have Chandler Council Member Terry Rowe. Chandler Council Member Renee Lopez. We have the Chief of the Chandler Police Department, Chief Duggan. We have the Assistant Chief of the Chandler Police Department, Assistant Chief Dave Newman. We have the Battalion Chief of the Chandler Fire Department, Battalion Chief Welsh. We have the CEO for ICANN, Becky Jackson. We have the State Representative, Steve Winiger, Legislative District 17, the Arizona House of Representatives. Thank you for coming. And we'd also like to recognize the following agencies: Mercy Maricopa, Integrated Care, Dignity Health, the Arizona Criminal Justice Commission, the Governor's Office of Youth, Faith, and Family. And there's a number of other organizations that are here, and we thank you all, and we welcome you here today. Prescription medication misuse and abuse has been declared a national epidemic by the National Center of Disease Control and Prevention, claiming more lives than heroin and cocaine combined. The effects on the lives of the citizens of Arizona and in the Chandler area are devastating. The truth of this current condition presents our state and our community with a great challenge. However, the greater truth is there is a solution. The RX Misuse and Abuse Initiative that you will hear tonight is a five-strategy plan of activating and uniting numerous vehicles from our community to collaborate here and attack this issue with a united force, allowing every citizen to become equipped and educated to take action in their area of influence. The plan has already been proven effective, and it has reaped great benefits in three other counties here in the state of Arizona. Tonight's response to this call to action demonstrates the power of people coming together under a shared vision to accomplish extraordinary events. What we tolerate as people will dominate. And tonight we declare that this issue, regardless of how it emerged, will no longer be tolerated in the lives of our children, of our youth, of our families, and our communities. Now please help me welcome to the podium Chandler Council Member Terry Rowe.
I guess I'm going to use the podium. Well, thank you for everyone for being here tonight. It's a hot day, and thankfully it's nice and climate controlled here, and so we get a chance to hear this important message and do it in a comfortable setting. And Ted, who is with the Chandler Coalition on Chandler on Youth Substance Abuse, Ted and I were detectives at the Mesa Police Department years ago, and so I'm very pleased to be invited here, and on behalf of the mayor and the rest of the council, we're proud of the efforts of your organization, and we certainly want to commend everyone that is here to help further this very important argument. We're going to hear some pretty exciting stuff about how the coalition is going to hopefully roll out and continue and get, you know, like a train leaving the station, get moving. And I think we welcomed everybody. State Representative Jeff Winiger from LD17, and I do want to say the Boys and Girls Club has a nice turnout here, and thank you for being here. And And our police explorers, you all always do a great job. And who else did I want to say? And ICANN, and Becky Jackson, and all the folks that, you all do such a great job supporting our youth. But I don't think this is just about our youth, and I know that you're going to hear that. A lot of focus on youth, and because, hey, they're our future, our hope, but this is about our community, and this is about, Ted and I, working in detectives, we actually ran into a lot of nice people that made big mistakes in their lives, and that was often because of drug abuse, so you haven't really seen how low people can get in their lives, but when someone thanks you for arresting them so that they can get away from drugs, it has an impact. So again, I want to thank you all for being here. Thank you for the invitation today. Again, on behalf of the Mayor and Council, congratulations on this project, and we look forward to hearing more. So thank you.
And for the record, Terry and I just retired yesterday. All right. I've had the pleasure of working under our next speaker when he was the chief of the Office of Child Welfare Investigations. And his commitment to excellence and his pursuit of the safety of the children of the state of Arizona is extraordinary. I'd like to call up a gentleman who has made and will be making major impacts on the state of Arizona in restoring families and promoting safety and health, and that is Mr. Greg McKay, the director of the Department of Child Safety.
Well, our loss was certainly Chandler's gain here with Ted Huntington. So thanks for those words, Ted. So thank you for inviting me here tonight. It was a really great welcome to me to get the message and be asked to come out and speak on behalf of some of the issues regarding RX drug misuse and abuse and how that correlates into long-term misuse of other substances and how I've seen that from both lenses, both as a law enforcement professional for 22 years and as the chief of the Office of Child Welfare Investigations and now the director of the Department of Child Safety. So thank you for including me here. Thank you for this opportunity. So just a brief little bit of background that just to say why I maybe could be here talking to y'all tonight to give you some insight. So 22 years of law enforcement background, both in Philadelphia, but 20 years here in Phoenix in the metro area. And my career started out in patrol, and then I worked in the criminal street gang unit where I saw a lot of violence and a lot of drug abuse leading to violence and all kinds of other vices out on the streets. And I followed that up with about 7 or 8 years investigating crimes against children. So child abuse, sex crimes, child neglect, much of it involving drugs. After that, I worked undercover. I worked fugitive apprehension, again, a real tendency towards drug problems in those lines of work. And then I finished my career as a homicide detective. And I can tell you from my profession in law enforcement for 20 years, it's very predictable to see the outcome of drug misuse and drug abuse and addiction and the outcomes if that is not confronted and dealt with by strong communities like this one. Moving on from that, 3 years in as a employee with the state of Arizona and the Office of Child Welfare Investigations and now director, I also see the impacts that drug abuse has in that endeavor. And they are shockingly, disturbingly similar. And I have my own children. I have 4 children of my own and all the friends and have coached all the teams and the softball teams and the football teams. And I always say, as the kids get older, once somebody starts to travel outside of the good path, and they start to make choices, please let me know so I can intervene and give them the tour of life as I can most certainly show them. And my kids kind of laugh, and fortunately it hasn't happened yet where I'd have to make that pilgrimage and show people around a little bit. But I can tell you that the message that I give is that that choice to escape and use drugs, whether that's a prescription or somebody's family member has something or it leads into sharing on the street and illicit drug use, that choice eventually is gone when it comes to no longer wanting to use. It's gone. So the term hooked is absolutely literal. Homelessness, incarceration, violence, victimization, poverty, and in the worst situations, an autopsy table. I've seen them all, and I've seen them both as a detective and now as the director of the Department of Child Safety. So just a few statistics to let you know about how this scourge is impacting our state and our communities. Our department last fiscal year received over 50,000 reports of child abuse and neglect. And of those, nearly 14,000 of those reports found that substance abuse contributed to the maltreatment. And last fiscal year, there were 4,000 babies born substance exposed or addicted to opiates, heroin, methamphetamine. And of our nearly 18,000 children in out-of-home care being cared for by the state of Arizona and all the wonderful foster families that we have that we don't have enough of, anecdotally, it's believed that about two-thirds of child removals from their families is somehow drug involved. So, you know, how do we combat this? Getting new foster homes is great, but does that get to the root cause of why we're there? Why the police are there, why we are there, why we are removing children, why other people are raising other people's children. So one of my good friends who recovered and now helps his community told me about how all the beds are vacating in his men's center for recovery because heroin got so cheap now. And basically the comparisons are for a dollar to $1.50 per day, per milligram of OxyContin. So 80 milligrams of OxyContin can get you maybe an 8-hour high, and that costs you about $80 on the street. Where by comparison, a daily fix of heroin might cost $30 to $60 as opposed to upwards over hundreds. And also that it's easier to get, and it's more powerful, heroin, that being. So the real concern is that prescription medication misuse and abuse is the gateway drug to all of these killers out there, namely heroin. So that's why I think it's very important that this is going on, that this education is going out, that just, you know, trying to escape or maybe the pain is a little bit too intense today using something, it leads to the downfall. And unfortunately, I have seen that. So what I've noticed too is that it seems like America right now, there's so much anxiety. I don't know how children can be children today. You turn on the news and you see everything from terrorism to fighting in American streets to just all kinds of depravity. And I wonder, when I was a kid, and you didn't really know what happened unless it was on the 11 o'clock news for a half an hour, and it happened in your community. Now there's constant stimulus. And our children, and even our adults, are looking for escape routes because they don't have the ability to cope, because maybe they don't have the means or the community, or they have trauma or things going on in their life that don't allow them to. So as you move forward, and I'm really interested in seeing what's been put together here, that focus on trauma and past trauma-related events of people using, and that struggling to cope and escapism is just such a prevalent theme that I think we should all really focus in on. So thank you all for this call to action. And I know that we'll heal our communities as partners through faith and education and outreach and through hope. So, you know, Proverbs 11:14 says, where there is no counsel, the people fall. But in a multitude of counselors, there is safety. So that's what you're all here for, I hope. And I need your help because the amount of kids in the community that we're caring for that need safety need a whole lot more than our Department of Child Safety can provide and a whole lot more than these law enforcement agencies can provide. So it's got to be a massive collaboration, a massive surge to make this better so that we're not talking about this 10 years from now. So thank you all again for having me. I'm looking forward to seeing the presentation, and God bless everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McKay. And now we will get to see the presentation, and that will be presented by our next speaker, who was had a very great impact and a lot to do with the creation and the implementation of this initiative in these three other counties. So Shana Malone from the Arizona Criminal Justice Commission will come up and give the presentation. Thank you, Shana. Is there anything you need?
Will you let me do that?
We will let you.
Ha. Okay. So Ted knows me, and he knows that I like to walk around. This one?
Check it.
Can you guys hear me back there? Yeah? Good to go? Okay. All right. So I got a lot to cover in about 35 minutes, so we're going to roll right into this just with this precursor. So you may be asking yourself, why is this data person from the Arizona Criminal Justice Commission up here talking to us about this? And I just want to give you a little bit of background about why it's me tonight. There's actually many of us that are in this effort, and just so happens that I drew the short straw and Ted had me come today, but there's many agencies involved in this. The Governor's Office for Youth, Faith, and Families. Deborah, will you raise your hand so people, and I'm doing this strategically so they can pick on you later. Tomi St. Mars from the Department of Health Services is here. Cynthia Martinez from Mercy Maricopa is here. Carlina Orozco from my shop is also here. Mary Marshall from the Maricopa County Attorney's Office is also here. And there's others that aren't here tonight that you'll see. And the reason that I say that is because what we're going to ask of you at the end of this is for you to all come together as one entity fighting this together, because this is so multifaceted that it takes an entire village around all of these efforts to get this started. So I'm going to jump right into some data. So you heard a little bit before, but I'm going to talk to you about this broadly, and then we're going to break it down into Chandler just so that you understand how pervasive this is in your community. So there's many factoids that are going to be thrown at you today, but one of the ones up there that I want you to take note of, and if you remember no other number today, I want you to remember the number 46. 46 people a day are dying from this. That is more than heroin and cocaine combined. And it is absolutely one of those things that when we look down the face at this, we're looking at an epidemic here. So it's 46 today, but that number continues to grow. And until we make a targeted effort around this, it will. And as Greg noted, and as Ted noted, and as Terry noted, there's a correlation here to heroin. We'll talk about that in a minute. That number is going to get greater and greater and greater. That's why it's so important that we come together. So what does it look like here in Arizona? Every year in Arizona, about 575 to 580 million controlled substance pills are prescribed. And about 60% of those are prescription narcotics, mainly to oxycodone, which is your Oxycontins and your Percocets, and hydrocodone, which is your Vicodins. So why does that matter? You don't have to be a math whiz to get this one. It's a probability issue. The more that you flood the market with anything, the more likely it is that people will have access to it, and the more likely it is that they will misuse and abuse it. So how bad is this problem here? In Maricopa County alone, there were enough prescription narcotics prescribed last year to medicate every single adult around the clock for 2 weeks straight. And we're lucky, because in other parts of Arizona, it's 4 weeks straight. Up north in the rural country in Mojave County, it's almost 5 weeks straight. So we're lucky here, but the point is, that's a whole lot out there. And in addition to that, It just means that there's an incredible amount of access. And when you combine it with some of these other issues that I'm going to talk to you about, you can see how real fast this becomes an epidemic. So who is it affecting? Well, it's certainly affecting our youth. And this was the piece of data that got me interested in this about 3.5 years ago. And I will actually never forget the wee hours of the night when I was running this data. And I was looking at the 2008 Arizona Youth Survey data. That's from our shop. And I had to rerun prescription drugs 3 times because I had never seen anything get remotely even close to alcohol, tobacco, or marijuana. And at that point, it was very clear that prescription drugs was running head to toe with marijuana use among our youth. So you might look at this and say, well, 6.3%, that's really not that bad. And Maricopa County sits a little bit below the average. But here's the take-home message today. It isn't just that 6.3% of our kids are misusing or abusing prescription drugs, and specifically narcotics. It's definitely how they're using them. I'm gonna show that slide in a minute. For those of you that are here from Chandler, your data is on the far right-hand side, and that's your, Greg called them gateway drugs. That's your gateway drugs, the 4 most common substances that kids use. So when you look at this across Maricopa County, I'm sorry, you're on the left-hand side. When you look at this across Maricopa County, you start to get a real good picture of, it's the same story that you see at the nation level, national level, alcohol first, marijuana second, cigarettes next, and then prescription drugs. So we've come a long way since that 2008 data. So we've made some decreases, but here is the take home. For those of you, how many of you in here are parents and have teenage kids? Okay, so this next slide is one that you need to pay attention to. So, well, that not that one, this one. So it isn't just that, we'll cheer for you in just a second, Ted. It isn't just that 6.3% at the state or 7.6% of Chandler kids are misusing prescription drugs, it's how they're misusing. So about a third are cocktailing, cocktailing with alcohol and cocktailing with prescription sedatives. So why does that matter? Tomi, who is a nurse, Tomi, what happens when you cocktail prescription narcotics with alcohol? What about when you cocktail prescription narcotics with benzodiazepine?
Respiratory depressant.
So how many of you that have teenage children think that your child would know not to go to a party on a Friday night and combine an Oxy 30 with a Xanax? Because they only get one shot at that. It's a one-time deal, and it can happen immediately, and it can happen swiftly. All right, so now let's take a look. Actually, let's go back and give Ted and Melissa and Becky some cheering here. Basically, you can see that in 2010, that's when you had your spike, right? And since then, y'all have done a really, really great job at bringing this down. So let's hear a round of applause for ICANN, first of all. Well warranted. But there's still room to move here, right? Because the one thing that I know about prevention from the years that I have been in this field is that the second that you let your guard down and the second that you stop, when you're in the face of an epidemic with so many things pushing the supply side up, is the second that it's going to start to creep up. So it's more important now than ever that you double down and that you do these efforts that we're going to talk about that will help you get a grip on this epidemic and definitely make a difference. So what about adults? So this is a little bit older data because Arizona doesn't have a standing adult substance use survey, so I'll apologize for that and just say that one of the things that you should take home from this is that it isn't, just like Terry said, it isn't just a youth issue. We definitely have our share of adults misusing and abusing. And in fact, we have a growing trend, right, among, can anybody guess? Who's the fastest growing group of people misusing and abusing prescription drugs? She's raising her hand. Older adults, that's right. Who's the next group? Gen X, okay. Tomi says no. Who is it, Tomi?
45 to 54-year-olds.
Why? Why would it be them? How many of you fall within that age range? This is a trick question. Good job. Most people are like, I'm telling you my age. Okay. Why are you the most susceptible? Because you get hurt. That's exactly right. And this is why I say that. Because this is the part of this ugly, silent epidemic that people don't get. The majority of people that get hooked, that's the word that Greg used, the majority of people that get hooked on prescription narcotics start out legitimately using them. The majority of people are legitimately prescribed because they have a legitimate pain injury. And then over time, what happens is that their tolerance for the drug goes up, and their threshold for pain goes down. And so what do? A little bit more and a little bit more, not because they're addicts doing addict-seeking behavior, but because they're trying to manage that pain. And then what happens? Respiratory distress. That seems to be the word of the night. Respiratory distress. That's how we're seeing so many of these overdoses happen among our older adults and certainly among our 44 to 54-year-olds. And the reason that I point out those two particular groups of people is because many of us care a lot about these young folks that are sitting back here, right? It's our job to not only cultivate them, but to keep you safe. And so if you think about 44 to 54-year-olds, they're most likely to have who in their house? Teens, right. And so when we think about access, that becomes very, very important. I'm going to show you a slide on that in just a second. So for those of you that are not already convinced, what is this costing us? Well, it's certainly costing us lives. We've seen a massive increase in the number of people losing their lives to this, and these are our moms and our dads and our uncles and our aunts and our grandmas and our grandpas and certainly our young people. How many of you pay taxes? Okay, all right. So you should care very much about this. So in addition to that, we're seeing a lot of people cycle through the emergency department. Some of them are frequent flyers, but others are just literally ending up there for abuse and dependency issues. And it's costing us because a large chunk of those are actually paid for out of our access system. So how many of you drive a car? You better not raise your hand back there. How many of you drive a car? All right. We're seeing a massive increase in the number of people that are getting behind the wheel of a car and driving under the influence of prescription drugs. Some are doing it because they don't care, but many are doing it because they're completely and utterly ill-informed, that just because a doctor prescribed you that drug, impaired is impaired. When you get behind the wheel of a car and you drive impaired, it is a DUI. But more importantly, you're putting everybody and everyone that you love at risk, right? Going through the roof. I think it was Greg that actually mentioned the number of babies born addicted. So who knows what NAS stands for besides TOMI? She doesn't get to cheat. Neonatal abstinence syndrome. These are babies that are born chemically dependent on narcotics. And again, what you can see there is that we're seeing a massive increase in this. But again, how many of you pay taxes? Okay. Take a look at that cost factor if you have laser vision and could read that. The average NAS birth costs about $31,000 relative to a typical birth, which is around $2,500. 78% of those are paid for by our access system. All right, the shift to heroin. So you've heard people talk about it. How many of you watched that Hooked on Heroin video where they blocked out? Okay, good. So what was the one thing that Doug Coleman from the DEA, Mike Frazier, who was the chief of police of Surprise, Maricopa County Attorney Bill Montgomery, what was the one thing that they all said was creating this massive increase in heroin use among our 18 to 24 middle to upper class kids? The one thing. Prescription narcotics, starting out in prescription narcotics. So right now we're dealing with this epidemic, but if we don't tackle this epidemic and keep our eyes on the prize, we're going to be looking at another one. And believe me, the cartels have been preparing for this. They're ready for this. They're shifting that supply in like wildfire, right? And so the access is there. It's cheaper, right? And as we start to do things around changing prescriber habits and making people more aware, there's another issue that we have to deal with here, right? Because we have a population that is legitimately already chemically dependent on prescription drugs. So we have to do this very carefully and have a treatment plan as well. Otherwise, people will shift out of access issues. All right, so what is amplifying this problem? So this is the most important thing, because these are the things that we can change. These are the things that are driving these rates up, and these are the things that we need to work on to change. So the first thing that I want to talk to you about is that, I talked to you a little bit about it, but there's really three groups of people here. And we talked about the chemically dependent, right? The people that get started legitimately out of a legitimate pain reason, and then become chemically dependent on the substance and would go through withdrawal if they stop. And again, I urge you to consider that the face of this looks very different than, say, what people might typically think of when they think about a drug addict. Again, these are your moms. These are your dads. These are your uncles, your aunts, your grandmas, your grandpas. The opiate-naive individuals, there's a whole bunch of them sitting back here, people that whose bodies aren't used to accommodating narcotics. And so what happens with them is that if they crush up a prescription narcotic and they put it in a beer and they chug it, they're getting the whole dose all at one time and their body simply isn't ready to accommodate, and then they overdose in the moment. And then there's the diverters. How many of you have heard of something called a doctor shopper? Yeah. These are people that go around from one doctor to the next doctor to the next doctor, and they accumulate scripts over and over and over again, sometimes to fuel their own habits and oftentimes to sell them, because as Greg said, these pills go for a lot of money on the street, depending on the dose and the street corner, right? So just a raise of hands. How many of you think that the group most likely to overdose is the opiate-naive individuals? Okay. How many of you think it's the chemically dependent? It's the chemically dependent. Because again, for all those reasons that we talked about. All right, so a lot of times when we give this talk, people get really angry real fast at the prescribers and say if they would just stop writing pen to paper, this entire thing would go away, but it's not quite that simple. The reality of it is that, it's almost two decades ago now, prescribers were told by their professional associations and the people that reimburse them, by the way, that they weren't assessing pain well enough. So much so that, in fact, pain became the fifth vital sign. So this is that question that you get when you go to urgent care, the emergency department. On a scale, I'm going to come pick on you because you're nodding. On a scale of 1 to 10, how much pain are you in? And what do you say, Renee?
Not much.
Oh, you say 15 because everybody does, right? They're in the most extreme amount of pain ever. And so what happens with that is that you just get this cycle that goes through. And then the other thing that happens is that oftentimes prescribers, they're very busy, and our health consumers tend to be a little unrealistic about what pain management is. So in addition to 15, their other expectation is that when they wait for 45 minutes to see that prescriber, they're going to come out of there with a solution, and it's going to be immediate, and it's going to be quick, and it's going to come in a little vial. And so they put the pressure on the prescriber, right? Some of these people are very agitated and very hostile. And so oftentimes they will threaten the prescriber with, I will give you a bad customer satisfaction survey if you don't give me the Vicodin that I want. And so you can see that it gets real complex real, real fast. So there's one thing that we have in Arizona that could alleviate a lot of this. Not all of it, but a lot of it. It's called the Controlled Substance Prescription Monitoring Program. That's a mouthful. So the CSPMP, it is a tool where every single drug, every controlled substance that is prescribed and dispensed out of a pharmacy is logged into this system, and it provides your entire medication history. So just like your prescriber would check your electronic health records before they did any procedure on you or talk to you about any kind of treatment, this system exists for them to look at your medication history. But only 35% of prescribers actively prescribing controlled substances in Arizona are using it. So can anybody think about why, after all the stuff that I just told you about prescriber offices, what might be a deterrent for them using it? Time. That is the biggest one. That's right. Time. And so we'll talk to you a little bit about something that people working on this initiative have put in place, but it's only going to be as good as we get it marketed and that prescribers know about this. All right, so easy access. So when I said that about moms and dads are the ones most likely to be getting hurt and getting prescribed, and grandmas and grandpas, why this matters, you can see real clearly here that kids in Chandler or anywhere else in Arizona, they don't need to go find a dealer to score prescription drugs because you're their dealer. Because you keep them in your unlocked medicine cabinets. You keep them in your purses. You keep them on your kitchen counters. Sometimes you put them in your nightstands, and sometimes you put them in your car consoles. And they are open for the taking. So a lot of times, have you heard of Skittles parties? Yeah, so what these parties are is that kids will take anything that they can get from mom's medicine cabinet, from dad's car console, like I said, and specifically now, grandma's purse, right? And they take whatever they can get. They bring them to a party on a Friday night. They put them in a communal bowl, i.e. the rainbow of colors. And they just pop one out. This, by the way, is all completely preventable. So at the end of this, Cynthia is going to give a call to action. And one of the things that we can do and do really well, and for all of you here, especially those of you that have kids in your house or kids in your neighborhood, and for you kiddos too, go home and tell your parents this. Lock them up. Absolutely keep them stored in a safe place while they're in the home. And when you're done with them, because there's a whole lot of them, when you're done with them, what should you do with them? You should not flush them and contaminate our groundwater supply, whoever said that. You should not do that. What should you do with them? Say it loud.
Take it to the police department.
Right. So you put them in these things called prescription drug drop boxes, and that just makes sure that they're incinerated in the right way so nobody's dumpster diving for them, because people do that. Again, they're worth a lot of money. People dumpster dive for them, and kids certainly dig through the trash for them. So lock them up. That's a call to action item, by the way. Go home, properly store your meds in your home, find out where these drop boxes are. Cynthia will give you a list of those. And get them out of your home if you don't need them. All right, so what else do we have going on here? So this thing about perceived risk, this always gets a lot of attention. So we know from 60 years of science that the more a child specifically thinks that a substance is harmful in some way to them, the less likely they are to use it, right? And so one of the things that I want you to know here, again, Chandler is on the left. So those of you that have been in coalition work for a long time, this is probably no surprise to you, right? That kids think there is absolutely zero risk of trying marijuana and not very much risk of using it regularly. And then about a third of kids say, well, there's some risk involved with alcohol. And about 20%, you're about 18.4 right now, say that there's absolutely no risk whatsoever in using prescription drugs. There's another side of this data, though. So we go out there and we do our programs, right? And we tell kids, if you take these, you could overdose. If you combine them with alcohol, you certainly could overdose, right? And then they go to a party on a Friday night, and what happens? Did their limbs fall off? They end up in the emergency department. So you got this positive reinforcement factor that comes. But it's not to say that it can't happen, right? And that's a heck of an odds game to be playing. So it becomes our job. Here's your call to action number two. It becomes our job to find efficacious ways to teach our kiddos about it will cause harm, and whether that harm is a physical harm or whether it's that Chief Duggan will show up at your door and arrest you. Anybody here from the schools? Okay, not tonight, okay? Or that you will get expelled from school, or that you will get kicked off of your football team. There are risks involved, and it's a really big gamble to be playing with those risks. All right, so before I show that real quick, there's another reason that we need to be very, very, very alarmed by this. I get to pick on you because you sat right in the front row. How old are you?
17.
Oh, goodness, 17. Okay, she's a little young for this question. How many of you here have kids under the age of 12? Raise your hand high. All right. Did you just raise your hand over there? That was funky. All right. So under the age of 12, let me ask you what you think. What is the average age that a kiddo in Chandler or in any other part of Arizona starts to initiate prescription drug misuse and abuse? 12. Good job. We're hiring. All right. 12 is the average age of initiation, right? But what if I told you this? What if I told you that 1 out of 8 kids in Chandler that misused in the past 30 days, 12 to 17 in our survey, started using in elementary school? How many of you here have an 8-year-old? I want you to look at that piece of the pie right there. So the message with this is two things. One, we got to start our prevention programming early, very early. In fact, if we have a hope from a pure prevention strategy of combating this. Two, need to talk early and talk often. And it may be a little bit uncomfortable. How would you talk to your 8-year-old about don't do drugs? That may not fit with their developmental state at the time, right? It's not developmentally appropriate. But there are things that you can do and are things that you can say that will set that path, that the likelihood of them making the right decision, right choice, when they get to that point will be increased. But if I said to you, can you go home and do that tonight? Would you say yes? Probably not. So what do we need to do? We need to equip him with the right material so that he can go home and have an effective conversation about that. All right. The other thing that's happening here is he may not be alone, because over half of parents in Arizona have never talked to their kids about alcohol or drugs. And why do we care about that? There's a really good know that when parents have those conversations with their kids are 50% less likely to engage in substance use. So what do you think it is here in Chandler? Take a guess, Melissa. What do you think it is? You think it's higher or lower than the state average? About the same. A little bit lower. So what does that tell you? It doesn't say give up hope. You're obviously doing a great job here. It tells you it's one place that you can make your mark, right? If you can get that material out to parents and convince them why they should talk to their kids, one, and how to talk to their kids, two, you'll move a mountain on this. It's one of those things that's tangible, and you can do it right off the cuff, right? We have something in our toolkit that will help you do that. All right, so one of the things that I'm a huge fan of is go right to the source. So I can quote science all day long, left and right, about the fields of developmental psychology and child development, family studies and sociology. But at the end of the day, I want to know from you, not her because she doesn't use drugs, but I want to know from you, what are the reasons that are contributing to you making that decision to use? And he actually, Greg, hit the nail on the hammer about something that has been concerning me. I've been at ACJC for 6 years, and I have been screaming at the rooftops about this for about that long. And this is something that we need to do something about. So again, for those of you that don't have laser vision, the first two reasons that kids told us that they use prescription drugs are something that we've known for a very, very, very long time in the field and in science. It's to have fun and to get high. But it's the third reason that scares me. That third reason up there, actually, it's the second reason in Chandler. It's the third reason in the state. But Chandler, again, here's the point for you to deal with stress. So we've got 12 to 17-year-olds saying that they're opening up a bottle of pills to deal with life stuff. The fourth reason there scares me equally, to keep from feeling sad. So we've got 12 to 17-year-olds who are opening up a bottle of pills, again, because they're going through something, whether it's a traumatic experience in their life or they're suffering from depression, they are self-medicating. I'm a former therapist. Why does this scare me so badly? And you're from DCS. Why does this scare me so badly? Wrap this up and fast forward 10 years. What do we have on our hands? Can't do what? And what does that mean for us? Unprepared, unhealthy, unproductive young adults. Right? That's a whole nother epidemic that we're going to be looking at. This is why it's so important that we jump in this game and that we stop this dead in its tracks. I'm also a big fan of knowing why girls like her, because her dad's sitting right here, so why girls like her say that they chose not to use, right? So that's equally important. And what you culminate from that information is it tells you where to double down. It tells you, okay, this is what kids are telling us are keeping them from using. Now we need to do more of that, right? And aside from not being interested in, the single biggest reason that kids say, make daddy proud, okay? The single biggest reasons that kids say they don't do prescription drugs to get high is what?
Parent disapproval.
Right. Because you did a good job of talking to her. You did a good job of setting the stage for her to know about the risks. You did a good job of setting clear expectations that we don't use. And you probably also did a good job of preparing her to cope, I hope. So preparing her to cope, right? So that's what we need to do more of. We've got to get those parents talking to those kiddos, setting those clear expectations, and certainly giving them the coping skills so that they won't fall into this trap. Now, reasons three can hurt me. Reasons four could be arrested. So they are afraid that you will show up at their doorstep. The important part of that is that tells you something else there. Again, educate about the risks. Again, educate about the external consequences, because different things will motivate different kids to not use. For her, it's her dad not being disappointed in her. All right, so what else is going on here? As Greg mentioned, it's a very lucrative business out there. In addition, we've got these folks. So in Mojave County, Tuesdays used to be known as Yay Day, and what would happen is Dr. Ye would drive over from the Nevada border and he would set up shop in a little strip mall. And at 6 o'clock in the morning, what would happen is the line would start forming around the corner like they were waiting for a concert. And what would happen is folks would bring Dr. Ye $250 and Dr. Ye would give them a script for 1,000 pills. So we definitely have these. And this is where law enforcement comes into play, because these guys are few and far between, but they do a whole lot of damage when they're there. Now, this is the worst case scenario, but we also have something called the candy man. And that are prescribers that are they're not as bad as Dr. Ye in terms of the volume and what they're doing, but they're certainly overprescribing to the point where they're putting the public safety at risk. That's where law enforcement comes into this. It's very important that you're educated on how to do diversion crimes, and we certainly have training to do that, but it's certainly being aware what's out there and what people are doing with this. All right, I'm gonna show you this just for a second because this is the typical thing that people think about when they think about a dealer. And the next slide that I'm gonna show you, I'm showing you for one reason, and that is to show you that this is the new face of the dealer when it comes to prescription drugs. She was a kindergarten teacher and taught six-year-olds every single day. She legitimately got into an accident, and she legitimately was prescribed, and she legitimately got hooked. And as she became chemically dependent, she started doctor shopping and selling drugs to keep up her habit. All right, so you package it all up, and this is what it looks like. So we definitely have things happening on the supply side, and we certainly have a whole lot happening on the demand side. And the only way that we're going to combat this is if we come together and we figure out how to target both of those sides at the same time to make an impact so that we're not putting a Band-Aid on cancer, so that we're actually making a concentrated effort to decrease the availability out there. So here's your pop quiz of the night. Just curious. Where do you think Arizona ranks nationally in terms of rates of misuse and abuse among 12-year-olds and older? Take a guess. Deborah, where do we rank? 12th. We're 12th highest in the nation. 3 years ago when we started this, we were 6th highest. So there's hope. What we're doing is working, but now we need to take it to scale. We need Arizona to do it. Where do you think we rank in terms of people dying? They're directly correlated. 12th, right? Again, 3 years ago, we were 6th highest. We are making progress, and I'm going to show you how. So this is kind of the mantra of our initiative. We came together, all those folks that you heard me talk about in the beginning, and none of us had any money. But we said, you know what? That's not going to matter. We need to do this. We need to figure out a solution to this. So what we did is we started leveraging each other's resources. You put in some money here. You put in some money here. We're going to go to these beautiful things called the community coalitions, who no one else on this earth will protect their own village greater than them and knows their own village greater than them. And they've been doing substance abuse prevention for years. And if anything, they can teach us a whole lot about what we're dealing with here. So we wrapped it all up. We brought a team of experts together from across all those sectors, law enforcement, the medical side of things. We even had the insurance companies there, certainly the community coalitions in the treatment world. And they came up with these five strategies. They said, this is what we can do in Arizona that's going to make a difference on this. And so you can read them there for yourself, and Cynthia's going to make a call to action in just a minute based on all five of these. And then what we did is we said, okay, we don't have any money, so we're going to pilot this in three rural counties to show proof of concept that it works. Those are the people from the core group. I will in just 1 second when I show you the evaluation results. All right, so the overarching goal here for Arizona is to continue to reduce this 18% by 2018. The Department of Health Services has set that target goal. And here's what I'm gonna show you, just so that you don't think I'm a snake oil salesman selling you something that doesn't work. In the three counties, it was Yavapai, it was Graham County, and it was Pinal County, but predominantly Casa Grande. They're the only city in Pinal County that did all five strategies. So here's what I'm gonna show you. And we certainly did things at the top level. So just so you don't think we're coming to you all at the community level and saying, you do all the work, and we'll sit up here and we'll take notes. That's not how it happens. What we do at the top state level is some policy work. We certainly do. Tomi has done a lot of work with prescribers. We've definitely been working with pharmacists, so all of those things. But we got to control what we can control, right? So we're here today to talk predominantly about the community level strategies and what that looked like and what it can look like for you. So when we said, let's reduce diversion and illicit acquisition, you remember those drop boxes that you talked about? So the first step was, you got to get them in, right? That was the first step. But they're only as good as if your community knows about them. So it couldn't just stop with get some boxes in place at the police department. You had to market that they were there, one. And if there's one thing I know about human behavior in the 19 worlds that I've worked in the social sciences and the applied world, it's that you have to convince them why. Why should you get in your car and take the effort to drive down to the police department and put them in there? And so a lot of that strategy became around marketing. So telling people, that poster that you saw about there's a new dealer in town, flooding the communities with those. flooding the communities with messages about why they should do this. And it worked. To date, in those three sites, 20,000 pounds of unused, unneeded, and expired menzer off the street. Now, is it the be-all, end-all? No, but it certainly does a lot and a long way to get some of it off the street, to get some of it out of the flooding of the market, so to speak. It's definitely something that's easy. I think you all have them in Chandler already. So now it becomes a function of marketing it, getting people invested in caring and getting people to get in their cars and drive them down there. Limiting youth access. So Arizona as a whole saw a 10% reduction in kids saying that they were obtaining them out of the home, but our pilot sites saw a 29 to 68% reduction, not just out of the home, but what I like to call the friends and family plan. Because just because you lock them up in your home doesn't mean your kids' friends' parents are locking them up. And so we saw a reduction across the board, i.e., it works. Prescriber signups, so that's CSPMP, we did a whole lot around this effort. At the community level, they used something called the Sign Up to Save Lives campaign. And it meant a whole lot because it was coming from communities. Us keep everyone safe and certainly our kids. And what you can see is we made a huge, huge, huge increase in both prescribers and pharmacists, but we're not done. Again, only 35 and change percent of prescribers are using this. We have a long way to go with that. So this is something, this is a new slide, by the way. You're the first to see this. So Tommy's going to smile here in just a second. So that CSPMP is only as good as if prescribers use it, right? So it's fantastic if we can get them to sign up for it. But it doesn't mean anything unless they're checking it, right? And so again, just so you can see, this model works. Since we started this in 2012, June of 2012 is when we started, we're sitting at almost 150% increase in prescribers using that system. It works, but we have to do a better job of marketing it. That time issue, and somebody back there said money, that time and money issue. So we're not a state that mandates use of our CSPMP. There's a couple other states that do that. But what we did is we offered them the option of a delegate, meaning the same exact person that checks your electronic health records and gets your patient chart ready can now do that for the prescriber. But again, it's only as good as if people know about it. So spread the word. When you go to your doctor, when you go to your prescriber, your NPs, anybody that you know prescribes, ask them, are you signed up and using the CSPMP? And tell them about this delegate role. It seems weird that a community member would do that, right? It's great conversation, by the way, especially when you hit one that isn't signed up for it. But it's doing that little part where you can, when you can, to make the difference. All right, and I'm going to skip through that and just get to the bones of this, what everybody cares about, i.e., did we reduce youth substance use? And at the state level, we certainly did. Between 2012 and 2014, we saw a 20% reduction with the concentrated effort in Yavapai, Graham, to some extent, Pinal County, because there were a couple other sites that did the youth-based stuff. Guess what it was? This was at the state as a whole. Guess what it was in Yavapai and Graham and Casa Grande? Close to 40%, almost double. In other words, this works. Graham County, for example, when we started this, was the third highest in the entire state. They're now at 1.9% of kids using, which is so low that I think I even was surprised at how low that was. Again, it works. So inpatient hospitalizations, those things that are costing us a whole lot. We saw a reduction across the state, pilot and non-pilot, but we saw double the reduction in the pilot sites. In other words, it works. But this is the big one. This is the one where very few of us ever get to go home at the end of the day, maybe some law enforcement people, to say, I saved a life today. This thing saves lives. We saw a 28% reduction in people dying in our pilot sites. Our non-pilot sites went up. So there's a lot at stake here with this. So summing it all up, putting it all together, what can you do? Well, the first thing is you got to buy into this, that this seems big, right? And there isn't a lot of money on the table to combat this issue, right? But at the end of the day, people are dying. And some of those people are our youngest and most treasured gift, and the people whose backs we will be standing on long term. We've got to jump in this together. We've got to all do it, not because of the money or the glory or the press or credit or anything like that. We got to do it because it's the right thing to do. And you just got to do it one step at a time. Do what you can when you can. So get marketing of the drop boxes out there. Absolutely. Team up with Tomi right here. Don't let this woman out of your sight before you leave and say, Tomi, how can we help? How can we partner with health services to do our part in our own backyard to get this information out to prescribers and pharmacists? Law enforcement. We have a HIDA diversion drug crimes training coming down the pike September 25th. Get everyone that works for you there. Everybody on the same page with this, because that's the only way we're going to keep Dr. Yeas from coming into Chandler. In terms of strategy 4, this is your baby. This is your public awareness. This is your education. You have been a rock star, Ted, at hosting RX360 curriculum trainings. It's a training that we do with parents and with kids in the schools. Get it out there. Spread that word. Get in front of people with it. But don't forget that even the little things, like handing out a parent talk kit to a parent, can make the difference of whether or not they have that conversation. Certainly getting up lots of posters and PSAs and all those great things that you do absolutely will help this. But don't forget that last strategy. It's the one that gets forgotten. And that's that treatment strategy. And that's that working in our local communities to make sure that as we do this work, people are navigated to treatment appropriately. That treatment is there, one. And two, that people have access to it and that our prescribers know where to send people with that. All right, I'm going to leave it there, Ted. Yes? Questions now or no? Is anybody brave enough to have a question? Ted's going to run a mic. You going to run a mic? All right. Okay, I'm going to run to you while you're busy hitting that, just for time's sake.
What do you think the effect of the possibility of legalization of marijuana would do, and how much would it multiply? I mean, not an exact number, but obviously I think it would make this worse.
I think that question's for you, Ted. Because that's a whole nother hour presentation.
Already evidenced that for us. And there's a lot of statistics that are going to be coming out of that, but that's another substance that we'll tackle along with this one.
I would just add to that. So any supposed studies that you think that you've seen or that have been publicized, check out the methodology in those studies and question whether or not that methodology is sound enough to be making those assertions about one is related to the other. Government speak for I'm not allowed to answer that.
You know, something we see, Jeff, is there's a, can you all hear me? Oh, it's for the recording. Okay. There seems to be a certain excuse or tolerance for substance exposure when it comes to marijuana with our organization. And what we've seen is on all of our fatalities and our child fatalities that we investigate, there's a high prevalence of marijuana involvement on prior substance-exposed newborns to marijuana, and then a future death that we're working on right now to try to prove some correlation, because people like to dismiss, well, it was only marijuana as opposed to a meth baby or a heroin baby, but we're seeing a real prevalence towards marijuana SEN babies, which is substance-exposed newborns, to later deaths. So we're working on that right now, if that helps.
As I'm heading over there, that reminds me that I think 60% of the cases that I worked in your office where we tested the 0 to 5-year-olds, 60% of them tested positive for marijuana when their parents had cards, marijuana cards.
Well, on behalf of the Boys and Girls Club of the Compadre Branch, I'd like to thank you for those words of yours. I just had one quick question. In terms of getting the word out there, we can tell parents all the time to tell their kids stuff, but chances are, I'll be honest, I'm a teenager. I don't always listen to my parents, you know. So I was wondering what efforts have been made to get kids like us educated in a way so that we ourselves could be ambassadors for people like you outside of, like, at schools and stuff, and, let's say, lack of a better word, preach these information to kids to let them know that let them know of the dire effects of drug use and substance abuse.
That might be one of the best questions I've ever gotten, so thank you for that. And we do have a curriculum that we use with kids to do that exact thing, to educate them. But you know what I would say? Ted, you just got one heck of a volunteer right here who says, I want to be in this. I'm in this fight. I believe in this. And you know what? Where some kids might not listen to their parents, which is very valid, right? They might listen to him. So here's what I would say. You see Deborah Miller sitting right over there. She's going to try to pretend not to be here now. So you see Deborah Miller? You need to go talk to her. Get actively involved. So get with Melissa, get with Ted, get with Becky, and get with Deborah too, and coordinate that. And you know what? I'd like to see a year from now, you're the face of this, right? That you're the one that gets this started in terms of that peer-to-peer approach and trying something new and out of the box that maybe we haven't tried yet. Because I agree with you. Hearing it from you is going to sound a whole lot different than hearing it from someone like me or someone like Ted even. So I appreciate that comment, and I say go for it.
For the strategy number four, the prevention and education piece, is focuses on one, the student, parent, and the community. And when we have our call to action, you'll have the opportunity to go and request and sign up for one of these presentations. So you can get a group together and then ask for a presentation to come to your group. And then you could also get the information and duplicate it. So that is strategy four. And I just want to make sure that we cover the five strategies and how they can connect to them as we leave here.
No questions? All right. Thank you.
Okay. Our next speaker is Stephanie Siete, and we're almost done here. Our next speaker is Stephanie Siete, and Stephanie is with Community Bridges, and having an East Valley focus so that our entire community out here is able to keep moving forward in this and making the greatest impact that we can is very important. So Stephanie's here to share with us a vehicle that she has for not only Chandler, but I know that that there is a Gilbert, and I think Scottsdale was in here, and I know the coalitions are, on how we can keep an East Valley focus moving forward.
I was just saying, I don't have any slides with me, but this is the most perfect slide that I could have used for my message. Usually I come out and speak about all the different drug trends and what have you, so that type of stuff I'm happy to help you with. We have a table out front. Make sure you grab some of the information. But as Ted has shared, you know, we started this effort, and I will tell you the mouthful, of East Valley Synthetic Drugs Task Force about 2012. And who would have thought, oh my gosh, we're here going to keep growing because of this problem. Now, we realize the acronym has kind of stayed, but our focus has been much more than just synthetic drugs. It's everything. It's just that message of what's happening in our community. And when I say this slide is so timely, who would have thought that our small group would have grown the way that it has and made the impact? We have, you know, you think East Valley, you're like, oh, so Mesa's there, Tempe, Chandler, Scottsdale's there. I've had people come up from Tucson. The message is getting out there. We've got people from coalitions, schools, police departments, public defenders, county attorney's office. People are showing up because they want to be involved. So, yes, we do have this great proactive membership of 100 plus people on an email, but we get on a regular basis 20, 30, 40 people. I'd invite all of you. You know, I love hearing the effort or the questions from youth. We would welcome any kind of partnership and collaboration. I want you guys to come learn about efforts. You know, sure, sharing the med return boxes, and then there's the big dump. I can talk things so many things so fast. Dump the drugs. I know you guys. Try practicing slowing down when I speak. effort on September 26th. And again, we have flyers and information outside. Shane is talking about RX trainings at HIDA. There's one coming up, take note, October 14th on heroin. And you've just heard the connection. So I think all of the drugs are a concern. All of our efforts are important. Whether we're a youth, whether we're an adult, whether we're in the schools or the police department, I think we always say it, right? We're not going to treat it away. We're not going to arrest it away. We're not going to prevent it away. That's why we're here. And my big thing that people know when they hear me speak is, can you tell five others, a neighbor, right? A golf partner, a sister, a friend. You hear what's happening. You hear this. This is your neighborhood. You've got to protect it. You've got to stand up. It's one thing to learn. The big thing is taking action. What do you do? So even if it's just some of the little things that you learned today, share that information. I also printed out the upcoming meetings for the 2015-16 year of the task force. They are outside on a, like I said, on a table. We usually meet at 10 a.m. We always meet at 10 a.m. We usually meet on Tuesdays, but it's going to be on Tuesdays and Wednesdays of this year. So again, Tempe's there, Chandler, Mesa, Scottsdale. I mean, I'm not just going to list cities. We're all there. You're all welcome. You all matter. So let's all kind of partner up on what we can do. Thank you for being here tonight. Is there anything else you'd like me to kind of cover? Okay, good. That's the shortest presentation I've ever given, right?
All right. We're getting ready for our call to action, and we have the five strategies. Strategies one and two are our medical, our prescribers. We have, if you are an individual who is involved in that, that is your profession, your background, you have influence there, then we have strategies one and two, which we have dignity health outside that will represent strategy one. If you have questions or concerns or any questions that they can answer, then please visit their table, encourage you to visit their table. Strategy three is the law enforcement piece, and that is the prescription drop boxes. They have the information on where to go, where to drop them off, what they can take, how to do it, and you can take that information from them. Also, if you're another law enforcement agency here and you're wanting to partner with them in the East Valley and in HIDA, then please connect with their table. If you have questions that surround RX misuse or really any other misuse of a drug that is of a law enforcement nature, then they are out there to answer that. Four is the education piece. So there are actual presentations that are pre-made that are dynamite, they're dynamic, they're 45 to 50 minutes, hard-hitting. They have an excellent video, a killer video that goes on that goes with it. And they can be presented to teens, to youth, junior high, high school, college age, to parents, and also just to the community. So if you are a community member that has a group of employees and you want a presentation for your employees, if you have a group of youth and you want that presentation given to them, then what we're going to do is we're going to have sign-up sheets at the two back tables. Some of the teen leaders from the coalition, which are back here in the white, raise your hands. And thank you for coming. These are our the teen leaders from the Chandler's Coalition on Youth Substance Abuse. They'll be back at the two tables. So they can remember to sign up, leave your name, check the boxes that you want. I think strategy five is going to be the rehabilitation. And that is knowing they can give advice on how to refer, when to refer, and what information they have. Also, Community Bridges is out there, right? Community Bridges will be out there. Did you want to mention something else? And then we also have Valley Hope Center, which is local right here for rehabilitation and information. And we have the River Source that is going to be focused on 13 to 17-year-olds, right, Chance? Okay, so all of these tables will be out there. And our next presenter is going to actually give our call to action and give some directions so we can start handing stuff out and putting our names to things and pencils to it. And that is Cynthia Martinez from Mercy Maricopa Integrated Care. And Cynthia, would you please come up and get this moving?
Hello. I will be assisting TED and the ICANN coalition to help implement all of the strategies here in Chandler. And I'm also providing technical assistance to 9 other community coalitions that will be addressing RX misuse and abuse in their service area. So I think today's meeting, the main purpose was to really get the information out there so we all know what's driving this epidemic. So who's on board? Who wants to join this effort? We all should be, right? Because this is truly a multi-systemic effort, and every single person in here can do something to help us implement at least one of the action items in the Arizona RX strategic plan. So what we're doing right now is that we're passing out this sheet. And on here, we want you guys to write down what are some of the things that your organization is already doing in order to address misuse and abuse, or what are some of the things that you're doing in your home to make sure that you're keeping your children safe from this epidemic. Shayna explained the 5 strategies very briefly. So please identify some of the ways that you would like to partner with the Chandler Coalition in order to implement any of the 5 strategies. And if you don't know exactly where you fit in, but you know that you want to do something, please take some time to come up to us and we will find and identify what that next action item might be for you. If anything else, I ask every single person in here to please go home, take inventory of your medicine cabinet, remove all of those RX medications from place and site and lock them up. Make sure to properly dispose of any RX medication. As Shayna mentioned, we do have the drop boxes in all of the Chandler PD substations. So please make sure to dispose of them properly. And finally, I think where we're going to head after this is that we are going to come up. Will you schedule a meeting? We're going to schedule a workshop so we can all come together and really figure out how we can tie everything together. And it would be great to have the youth there so we can figure out how you work into the Chandler strategic plan, as well as all the other organizations that are here today. So on your way out, if you could please turn in that action sheet in the back tables, please don't forget to sign in, and Ted will make sure to follow up with an email along with the time and location of the workshop that he will be hosting in order for all of us to come up with a strategic plan for the city of Chandler.
All right, and I believe our tablers are back outside at their tablers. Please take advantage, connect with one or all of the tables, get the information that you need and want. It really is amazing to have all of the vehicles here, to have law enforcement, to have dignity, to have community bridges, to have the governor's office, to have all of the vehicles that we have here. All of them coming together like this really is a big and amazing event, and that's what gives us hope, and we know that we are going to make a huge difference. Thank you all for coming. If there's any other questions that I can answer or any of the speakers or panelists, then please come and ask us. We will, like Cynthia said, the plan now that we've had a call to action, we've identified the different strategies, and we're going to go out and find champions in each of these strategies, so that we can put together a subcommittee, and then we're going to springboard off of that subcommittee, and just fill this city with the information they need to equip, empower, overcome, and create change for healthy and strong families. So thank you very much for coming. It's a pleasure to see you all, to meet you all with such an intimate group. I'm looking around and saying that, you know, this is, we can probably all just kind of get to know each other, shake hands, make sure that you young adults come and meet the chiefs of the police department, the fire department, the assistant chiefs, come and meet the state representatives, come and meet some of the executives from Dignity Health and the governor's office. Take advantage of this. So thank you very much. Have a wonderful day. And we will meet again probably in about a month, those that are going to spring forward. Thank you.